Now.
Good evening and happy new year to all. This is Benedict Lecca, director of the Redwood Library, presenting from my art history man cave in East Greenwich, Rhode Island. And I want to welcome everyone. How fitting to start the new year with the ever popular Dr. Edward Markward as he continues his music appreciation series. And first of all, I want to also acknowledge the generous support of the Jarzombek family, Marianne Jarzombek, Mark Jarzombek of MIT, and Michelle Drum of Gustav White Realtors down the street. So tonight, Dr. Markward is going to be examining the Nationalists, Grieg, Sibelius, Falla. And I'm not going to go on and on about telling you about Mr. Markward and how much we like him, but since you know him well. So here he is now. Welcome, Dr. Markward, and Happy New Year to everyone. Thank you.
Happy New Year, everybody, and thank you for tuning in. Tonight, we're going to talk about the end of the 19th century, the last, 40 years or so, and crossing into the 20th century. It's a period of transition, and it's fraught with question marks as to whether one is a romantic or a modern composer. And the three composers we're going to explore tonight, Edvard Grieg, the Norwegian, Manuel de Falla, that's F-A-L-L-A, a Spaniard, and John Sibelius from Finland. And they all solve the problem in quite unique ways, each in his own way. The established repertoire at this time was dominated by classical music in almost every genre. In opera, symphonies, solos, chamber music, we have Mozart and Haydn. In opera, Mozart through Wagner, Verdi and Bizet. Orchestral and chamber music, Haydn through the late Romantics, which include Brahms and possibly Gustav Mahler and Anton Bruckner and so on. And in the keyboard area, J.S. Bach, Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, and the prominent 19th century pianists, composers, Chopin and Liszt. Modernism is rather undefinable at this particular time. Composers sought a place beside the classics, and they tried to mix innovation or new things with emulation of the past. And this is sort of like happened at the end of the classical period and moving into the Romantic period, trying to harness these new ideas in old framework or dress up. It extends aspects of the practice of the classical period to extremes. For instance, Mahler, Gustav Mahler, extends the length of symphonies by nearly half and introduces voices such as in the second and the eighth symphony. Schoenberg and others, principally Webern and Berg, will stretch tonality to the limits. And they reinterpret the familiar elements of the sonata form, for instance, in new ways. Also, and this is according to Donald J. Grout, the author of The History of Western Music, which every student has probably used, is the birth of isms. And I'm not talking about the political isms of communism, fascism, Nazism, and so on, but the isms of romanticisms and exoticism from the 19th century. And new in the 20th century comes impressionism of Debussy and Ravel, expressionism, primitivism, neoclassicism, serialism, all kinds of isms. And then in the second half of the century, of the 20th century, with folks like Steve Reich and John Adams, we get minimalism, postmodernism, polystylism, neoromanticism, and return to the semblance of tonality. I call that tonalityism. The use of conventional gestures in these works became problematic. And so the early 1900s became post-tonal in a divergence from the common practice of harmony and even atonality became popular, thanks to Arnold Schoenberg and others. There was also contributing to this dichotomy a widening schism between classical and popular music. If we look to the past, a lot of the popular music was in the folk idiom. And this carried on through Brahms, through Grieg, we will find out, and even through Kodály and Bartók in the 20th century. The national flavor, or looking to nationalism, helped composers bridge this gap between Romanticism and modernism. We began to explore this a couple of lectures ago with Fauré in France, Dvořák in Bohemia or the Czech Republic, Tchaikovsky and the Mighty Five in Russia, and now we're going to look at Edvard Grieg in Norway. Nationalism was still a potent force in the arts, in culture, and in politics. And composers were expected to write music true to their national identity, but also speak to an international audience. So composers synthesized a personal style from a mix of national and foreign influences and a mixture of new and old music. And as you can imagine, this led to a vast diversity of styles in the body of music. Edvard Grieg, who lived from 1843 to 1907 and became one of the first to bridge this gap, studied at the Leipzig Conservatory and absorbed the tradition of Mendelssohn. And he forged a distinctly Norwegian idiom in his early songs and piano pieces and short orchestral suites, using the dance rhythms of Norway, the harmony of the folk music, and a combination of 3/4 and 6/8 meter. That may sound complicated, but it's not if you remember Leonard Bernstein's America. I like to be in America, okay, by me in America, 1 and a 2 and a 1, 2, 3. This becomes popular at this time in Grieg's music, and also we'll find out in the Spanish music of De Falla and others. He wrote a series of Norwegian dances, a piano concerto, which is an early opus, and opus 16, and is clearly a romantic piece. He not only mirrored the key of Robert Schumann and chose A minor, we're going to listen to the opening bars of each of those concertos, and you'll find the descending piano figure, basically chords, followed by an orchestral playing of the melody, and then the piano comes back in. First, let's listen to Schumann's piano concerto in A minor. Let me try that again. After those opening chords from the piano, it becomes very lyric. I think you can hear that. Let's now listen to the opening of the Grieg piano concerto in A minor. By the way, the Schumann is opus 54, and it's rather a middle to late period work from Schumann. For Grieg, it's opus 16, and it's a very early work steeped in the romantic tradition. Thank you. orchestral statement first before the piano returns. I think you can hear clearly this, the resemblance of one to the other, and the romanticism, the romantic style that is involved in both. So clearly this is before Grieg decided to become a nationalistic composer, and he used folk melodies, folk rhythms, and here's a Norwegian dance by Grieg, and I think you can feel the flavor. Not that we all know much about Norwegian folk music, but I think you can hear a bit of what we're after here in the Norwegian dance number two. In addition to that folk dance sort of piece, he set two suites to the legend of Peer Gynt after the play by Ibsen. He wrote two suites in 1888, the second was in 1893, and they started as incidental music to the play by Ibsen. Unfortunately, the music that Grieg wrote was an hour and a half long as incidental music to an already 2+ hour play. So as you can imagine, Ibsen was quite upset as the music began to upstage the actual play. Thereafter, the incidental music was left out. So Grieg wrote these two suites called the Peer Gynt suites. And I'm going to play a bit of the first one for you. I believe it is the more famous of the two. I think you will recognize it. The first part I'm going to play is called Morning Wood. Next time you take a cruise around the fjords of Norway, you can think of this particular piece. I think you probably all know the tune that I'm going to play next, but maybe not that it's from Peer Gynt Suite Number 1. This is the famous In the Hall of the Mountain King, which is sometimes played on Halloween concerts and other Pops concerts. I'm going to try to get there. This is the end of Amitra's Dance. Another one. And here comes In the Hall of the Mountain King. Hi, Karen. Tell you from experience that that ending with the what we call an accelerando or faster and faster sometimes gets to be a race between the orchestra and the conductor to see who finishes first. Not at all a pleasant experience if you're the conductor. We move on then to modernism and nationalism in Spain. And the three leading composers of, during this period of time, the term later 19th century and the turn of that century, are Albéniz, Enrique Granados, and Manuel de Falla. And we're going to spend our time today on Manuel de Falla, who lived from 1876, pardon me, to 1946. So he bridged a good deal of the 20th century, early 20th century. In the case of all three of these composers, they became very interested in the folk tradition of Spanish music. De Falla himself collected and arranged national folk songs. And in the earlier works, the melodic and rhythmic qualities of Spanish popular music were used, much as, in France and in America, composers around this time, the early 20th century, and later when you think about Aaron Copland and Leonard Bernstein and people of that period began to use jazz, American jazz, in their music. So that would be the equivalent to what these composers were doing with Spanish popular music and folk music. They also used the national elements via the folk tunes that they discovered and the rhythms. I think you will note when we listen are very akin to Spanish guitar music that we're all sort of familiar with. Another thing about De Falla is that he spent a good amount of time before World War I in Paris and became very enamored of Debussy's music, especially Debussy's use of Spanish influences in pieces like Iberia, for instance. He was very impressed with Debussy's ability to invoke Spanish flavor. The national traits, folk and modernist elements, the homage to Debussy found his way into his later works as well. He actually quotes some of Debussy in his later pieces. We find the habanera rhythm, such as you know in Bizet's Carmen, flamenco and melodic and harmonic gestures, typical guitar technique with strumming and plucking, harmonics and strings tuned in fourths. And the plucking of the guitar, of course, is imitated in the strings. Sometimes he actually used, as did Albéniz and Granados, used the guitar in their works. Excuse me. In 1939, before we get to the music, De Falla moved to Argentina to escape Franco and the revolution. And his remains were brought back to Cadiz in Spain and buried in the cathedral in 1947. Two of the works that we are going to concentrate on this evening are his opera La Vida Breve, which is a love triangle and filled with blood and death and love. And it's a very powerful verismo kind of an opera, like Puccini, Mascagni, or Leoncavallo. Puccini, especially in works like Tosca, Mascagni in Cavalleria Rusticana, and Leoncavallo in I Pagliacci, for instance. So let's give a listen to a danza from the second act of La Vida Breve. My wife Diana and I had the pleasure of hearing this opera in Jackson Park in Chicago, conducted by the late great Eduardo Mata in 1994, which was about a year before he was killed in an airline crash. And it influenced me so much and turned me on so much that within 2 years I conducted this opera at Rhode Island College. I think you'll find it very, very powerful. Here's the danza from Act Two. And you'll note there's chorus, castanets, guitar type sounds, and multi-rhythmic kinds of things alternating between three and two, again, as we've heard earlier.
I'm
And so it goes. I think it feels to you as it does to me, very Spanish flavored, which is no surprise. But notice the castanets, the stomping in the dance, much as you would see in a folk dance of the same people. He also wrote two more ballets. Well, he wrote a lot of music, but what, what I'm going to concentrate on is the second of the two ballets. The first is El Amor Brujo, which he wrote in 1915. And then in 1916 through 1919, he spent 3 years writing El Sombrero de Tres Picos, the three-cornered hat, which is probably Manuel de Falla's most famous work. It is also a ballet and imbued with melodic and rhythmic qualities of Spanish popular music. And it was not quite what people expected of a ballet. It was commissioned by Sergei Diaghilev of the Ballet Russe, which also commissioned Ravel's Daphnis and Chloe, the three big ballets in addition to other works of Igor Stravinsky, and choreographed or staged The Afternoon of the Faun by Debussy. And all these were rather cutting edge, not only in the ballet sense, because they were all different from what was expected, say, for instance, from Tchaikovsky's Swan Lake. But they were cutting edge musically as well. The story of the three-cornered hat is of a magistrate infatuated with a miller's faithful wife who attempts to seduce her, and you can imagine it gets pretty messy after that. Incidentally, it was first performed in London in 1919, and the sets and the costumes were created by none other than Pablo Picasso. The conductor for our performance today is Ernst Ansermet, who was the conductor of the first performance of this this ballet. Diaghilev had asked Falla to conduct it himself, and after one rehearsal, he decided he wasn't a conductor, he'd stick to composing. So Ansermet took over and conducted the first performance of this work. This is from The Three-Cornered Hat, Part One, the introduction. So you notice that this Spanish flavor with the castanets and the stomping of the chorus, and by the way, the soprano is Teresa Berganza, is the same as it was in the opera. There is a soprano solo throughout this ballet. I'm going to play now the scene that is the Miller's Dance of the Miller's Wife, and I would like you to notice the guitar influence in this particular movement. Thank you. Again, as in the earlier pieces that we played of Falla, there is this changing of rhythm, which makes it quite interesting and also lends it a certain energy, as well as with the castanets, the percussion, the dancing on the floor. It just is so energetic. The final dance is called a jota. That's J-O-T-A. And it's a dance in three. It's based on a folk dance and is danced in couples in fast triple time when it's a folk dance. Here, it is very complicated rhythmically. Falla took a lot of liberties with this dance, basic simple dance, and it becomes very, very complex. Also, if we get far enough, you may notice a bit of Debussy-like spots, and I'll try to play the ending for you because it's very much like Firebird of Igor Stravinsky. And note that this work was premiered some 8 or 9 years after Stravinsky's Firebird premiered in Paris. The final dance from part two of The Three-Cornered Hat. Starting to sound more like 20th century. Get on to our next composer, but for those of you who are interested, this is a very classic recording with Ansermet and the orchestra, the Suisse Romande, and it was recorded in 1961. And keep in mind that Ansermet also conducted the world premiere in 1919. He was really a great conductor and conducted many, many world premieres of many of the leading composers of the day. We move on now to Jean Sibelius, a Finnish composer, Finland's greatest composer, at least up until the time of Esa-Pekka Salonen, I suppose. He lived from 1865 until 1957. And from 1809 to 1917, Finland was actually part of the Russian Empire, but culturally was more affiliated with Sweden and actually dominated by Swedish culture. Sibelius became a Finnish patriot and sought to create a national style. And the themes for his vocal works, symphonic poems, are from the Finnish epic, the Kalevala, which is a folk term for Finland and means the land of heroes. And he is also well known and much sought after as a conductor of his own works, much like Mahler, except that Mahler, of course, didn't conduct his own works very often. The Kalevala was compiled by Elias Lönnrot, and it was based on folk material, and it is the dwelling place of the chief characters in this land of heroes. The first work I'm going to play for you is the swan, part of the Swan of Tuonela. The English horn portrays the swan floating majestically down a very fast stream. It is a tone poem of which Sibelius wrote several, all based on the Kalevala. The hero of these pieces is named Lemminkainen, and he's sort of a combination of Wagner's Siegfried and Don Juan. He's a Finnish mythological character. During this time, Sibelius also wrote a very, very wonderful violin concerto, and then seven symphonies from 1899 through 1924. Let's listen to a bit of the Swan of Tuonela, which is absolutely wonderful painting of this nature scene. Notice how the English horn just soars above these shimmering strings. Just a wonderful effect as he portrays the scene in nature. And nature was very, very important to Sibelius. We'll talk a little bit more about that a little later in this talk. His style, he used a lot of modal melodies, which means not a lot of major key scales, uncomplicated rhythms, and the insistent repetition of brief motives. And what that means, he developed a rotational way of presenting things, especially in the symphonies, in which a little bit of a melody will be, or a theme will be played at first, and then it expanded, repeated, varied, repeated, expanded, varied, repeated again, until the accumulation becomes quite powerful, for instance, by the end of the symphony, especially the two I'm going to play parts of for you tonight, the second and the fifth. I think probably another tone poem is perhaps Sibelius's most familiar piece, and that is Finlandia, Opus 26. It was written in 1899. From 1897 onward, Sibelius was supported by the Finnish government as a national artist. You remember, perhaps a long time ago when we talked about Beethoven, he also received, although from a private source, money to support him for the rest of his life. By 1900, after this performance of Finlandia, the world premiere, his international reputation was much secured. The piece Finlandia was composed for the press celebrations of 1899. It was a covert protest against increasing censorship from the Russian Empire. And it was the last of seven pieces performed as an accompaniment to a tableau depicting episodes from Finnish history. So here we see Sibelius, not only a nationalist composer, but a patriot. Remember those two tones. They will become very important. The same two tones become the basis for this allegro section. Coming up momentarily. Same two tones, now expanded into a melody. And the part you've been waiting for. Thank you. And so I'm sure you know the rest of it. I'd like to move on to the second symphony, which is also suspected to be connected to Finnish independence. As a matter of fact, it was popularly dubbed the Symphony of Independence. It's the Symphony No. 2 in D major, written in 1902. He began the work in Rapallo, Italy, shortly after the successful premiere of Finlandia, and he finished in 1902 in Finland. And Sibelius said, "My second symphony is the confession of a soul." Another pundit exclaimed that the premiere exceeded even the highest expectations. I'm going to play for you the end of the second movement as it lead, or the sorry, the third movement, as it leads into this magnificent, patriotic fourth movement of this symphony. It'll take me a minute to get there, but listen to the opening of the third movement. It's a scherzo. All the movements together, one, two, and three, seem to be building to this great climax of the fourth movement. And as a young boy, I owned this recording given to me by my father, and I would lie in bed with the hi-fi on, listening to the end of the second movement and heaving a big sigh of relief when we finally got, or the third movement, when we finally got to the fourth movement. It is such a denouement. It's really unbelievable. Such a great, great, great symphony. And all that material in the last movement has been hinted at through the first three movements. And finally, you get to hear it full blown with those majestic fanfare type themes from the trumpets. One of his favorite things to do, I think you noticed them also probably in the Finlandia. We're going to take a peek at the Fifth Symphony now, which is a pivotal work. He wrote this symphony for the first, well, he corrected it or revised it twice. It was first written in 1915. He revised it in 1916 and then again in 1919. Why is that important? The first iteration was in four movements, as a typical symphony might be, with four contrasting movements. The same is in 1916, as he tweaked it a bit. And then in 1919, he shortened it, combined the first two movements into one. And again, they all lead to the magnificent last movement, in this case, the third movement. Why is it pivotal? When he wrote his Fourth Symphony, which is almost his most daring and most modern symphony, it was not very well received by the critics. So Sibelius had to make a choice. Am I going to stick with what I know and write this romantic music, albeit with perhaps some modern twinges to it, or am I going to go full bore and write modern music? He made the decision to stick with what he knew. By 1910, he had sort of fallen out of favor, at least on the continent. And by the 1920s, after writing 5, 6, and 7 in a seemingly short period of time after the revision in 1919, he quit composing altogether because he felt that he didn't belong anymore. His music, however, did remain very popular in Britain and in the United States, largely due to Leopold Stokowski and Eugene Ormandy, later with the Philadelphia Orchestra. The recordings we've been listening to with Sibelius were all recorded by Sir Colin Davis and the Boston Symphony Orchestra over a period of about 7 or 8 years. Sibelius was inspired to write the Fifth Symphony by a rather imposed illness that left him being isolated at his home on a lake. And one morning he witnessed 16 swans flying over the lake. They so inspired him that he used what he thought was their call as the swan theme in the last movement of this Fifth Symphony. It is my favorite symphony, and what Sibelius had to say about it was that it is as if God Almighty had thrown down pieces of a mosaic from heaven's floor and asked me to find out what the original pattern was. I'm going to play a bit of the last two movements as we're running out of time. Again, maybe I'll just go to the last movement so we're sure to get it in. And listen to again how fast it starts. And then, as in the case of all the movements in this symphony, they start fast and end slow. The fifth movement of the symphony, number 5 in E flat, opus 82. Hear the swan theme entering this early, if only briefly. It's in 3 and takes 3 beats. And then a bit of that scherzo like opening comes back, and then I will play for you the finale, which is famous all by itself because there are six staggered chords at the end of this movement, which were not in the first, neither the first creation or the first revision in 1916, but added in the 1919 version. This was a symphony that was written and tinkered with throughout the First World War and finished a year after the war had ended. And there are those, and I sort of lean this way, that these last pounding chords are either remnants of the war that had just been fought, or they were the presage of sounds to come some 20 years later in the Second World War. The thing that stands out above all is that Sibelius made this choice to stick with his romantic know-how and write what he knew best rather than change styles. To put that in perspective, that is that in 1909, Arnold Schoenberg pushed for more and more dissonant and chromatic harmonies in his five pieces for orchestra. Between 1910 and 1913, Stravinsky had written Firebird, Petrushka, and The Rite of Spring. Maurice Ravel and Claude Debussy were at work developing and performing what has become known as Impressionism, and they were also, all of these, staged by Diaghilev in the ballet Russe. Let us listen to the end of this, and then you can decide whether it's modern or whether it's romantic, a bit of both. And we'll explore more next time how we get across the chasm between the two that exists between Romanticism and Modernism. Here's the end of the Symphony No. 5 in E flat by John Sibelius. Thank you. the end. If you have any questions, perhaps we can take them now. Thank you. There he is.
Thank you very much, Dr. Markward. Please, as always, you know, so informative, and we're so grateful. Thank you all so much. And I'm looking at the list of people chiming in from greetings from cold North Carolina, Karen Jackson Geary, apparently a friend. Yeah. But anyways, thank you so much. Next month, please join us on February 17th when Mr. Markward will continue the series with The Rites of Spring, Part 1, Debussy, Ravel, and Ives. I should also mention that we are due to announce our winter series shortly, so please check on our website and stay tuned for lively presentations during the winter months. And as always, thank you for attending, everyone. And thank you again to Dr. Markward. Thank you very much, everyone. Good evening.
My pleasure.